And I'm honored to be welcoming our distinguished panel. And thank you all for coming tonight. The title of the panel is Cuentos de Arte, the Chicano Artists of Our America. Judithe Hernandez, Ester Hernandez, with Tere Romo. LA-based Judithe Hernandez and Ester Hernandez of the Bay Area are widely recognized artist activists of the Chicano movement, with works on view at the Crocker Art Museum exhibition. Art America, the Latino presence in American art, opens until January 11th, 2015. San Francisco art writer Tere Romo has recently published a professional biography of Melquia Montoya. These prominent Chicano artists will discuss their participation in the Chicano art movement, but also the special challenges of women artists today, then and now. I'm honored to be introducing our distinguished panel. It was an opportunity to pursue my passion for contemporary art history that brought my sister, Virginia, I don't see her, I think she's parking, and I to Judithe Hernandez, a member of Los Four, the first Hispanic artist to show at the Los Angeles County Art Museum in the 1970s. Judithe graciously agreed to come to Sacramento State and propose the title and the content of this artist panel. And I want to thank her for that. Our local Sacramento Bee critic, Victoria Dahlke, in a recent feature article stated, "The compelling images from Our America, the Latino presence in American art, another spectacular show from the collection of the Smithsonian American Art Museum." The Crocker is one of only five venues in the country that will host the show, which includes nearly 100 works by artists of Mexican, Puerto Rican, Cuban, and Dominican descent, as well as other Latin American groups with deep roots in the United States. Following the conversations led by Tere Romo, the artists will have 15 minutes for questions and will also be available between 7:30 and 8:30 for a reception in the Robert L. Gallery patio, hosted by the Sacramento State Art Department, the Art History Club, Sacramento Fine Arts Center, and its partners. Also, we're excited to feature one of our own women artists, Liz Courtney, and Faith Bonsoler. I hope I said her name right. If you have not seen the exhibit in the Robert L. Gallery and the Wood Gallery, please stop in. They will be open during the reception. I want to thank you all for coming and thank Elaine for letting me do this introduction. Thank you.
Can you hear me okay?
Is it on?
It's on, yes.
Okay. I too want to give my thanks to Elaine and to Marie for inviting us here to this panel and for all of you coming out to show support to our Chicana artists. And I just want to let you know that we are going to be doing a couple of things. We're going to start with the artist presentations, and then I'm going to give sort of an overview before we actually start the moderation part of it, because we do have a couple of questions we want to ask them, but then we're going to open it up to all of you to make sure if you have any questions that you can ask them. So I'm not going to reintroduce the artist. I'm going to go ahead and give it to Ester Hernandez, who's going to start the presentations with her PowerPoint.
How do I do that? Oh boy, technology. On the full moon. Dangerous.
Okay, just what the space bar.
What is
the other day. Clips.
Yeah. If you've looked at me long enough. Thank you all for being here, and thank you very much, Marie and the staff, for inviting us over. I just got in about an hour ago from San Francisco. It was hard to leave the fog behind and come out this way, but I'm from the Valley originally, so yeah, it feels kind of good too, to sweat. Let's see, what was I going to say? Yeah, San Francisco, the home of the Giants. Now we're going to take it, okay? And, you know, sorry about Timmy, though, but, you know, they made him stop smoking, so what can we say? Timmy, you know what I'm talking about, or not? Lincecum. Okay, well, like I said, I was born and raised in the San Joaquin Valley, out there by Fresno and Tulare County, a small little town called Dinuba. Sort of just right down below Sequoia Park. And I come from a farm worker family, and we worked mostly in the grape industry, in particular working, picking grapes for the raisin cooperative, in particular Sunmade. But when I think about the influences in my life as far as being an artist, I always have to go back to my family and to my community, because it was through their own personal involvement in the arts. Even though they were farm workers, they always found time to create beauty, whether it was embroidery or gardening, or my father also loved to do amateur photography, and he also liked to do drawings and posters and things along that line. And my grandfather was a master carpenter, and on his spare time, he also carved sculptures, and all religious sculptures mostly, but sometimes things more functional, like shoeshine boxes for my brothers to like make a little bit of money on the side. So for me, I would say the first time I really thought about art was probably when I was about, well, not art as art, but just the ability to sort of be aware of the world around me and sort of work with its plasticity and to come up with something that's unique and whatever, was like when I was probably about 2 years old and I fell in some mud, okay? Bad news, because I had a fancy dress on. So, but when I fell in that mud, I just started playing with it and manipulating it. And then the next day I went back and I could still see my hand and like all of my movements, and it really affected me immensely and deeply. So I just kind of continued as a child working in the grape fields. As you know, they're very sandy and they flatten them out so that you can put the grapes in the middle on top of paper to dry. And when I was little, a child, I would literally just go out and just draw in the sands and work with the leaves and make little stencils and just decorate myself until I was old enough to work anyway. But even on the side, I did things. Can you hear me? Okay, because I'm kind of... So I continued with that obsession with art, and I had like my first outside of school exhibit when I was in the first grade. So, and I just sort of continued. So like really, it's like almost 60 years that I've been mad dog artist and exhibiting. So the reality was those small little farming towns really don't have a lot of money. You know, they're like they small little cow towns out there, beautiful people, but there's just not a lot of money to support the arts. So eventually I sort of moved around. I was a hippie for a few years, and then I came back and I moved into the Bay Area where I am now. So that pretty much brings me up to this point with these these photos here of when I moved into the Bay Area. I had the pleasure of meeting Malaquias Montoya, who's here with us this evening, and he was a major, major influence in my life. Not only technically, but spiritually, and also politically, in terms of what he had to say about the importance of art in the community and the importance of giving back.
So I met him and I met some other people, and I have to say the baddest artists, oh, excuse me, she's from LA, Judy's from LA. The baddest artists are from the San Joaquin Valley, honey. Okay. All right, you heard it. Nothing personal. What's that? I think you're from the Valley though, sometime way back, right?
I have relatives in Dagnuga. Oh. We need to talk.
I forget you. See, okay, see what I'm talking about? Okay. Anyway, I moved into the Bay Area. I went back to school. I landed up meeting other Chicano, Latino, and progressive artists. And I went to UC Berkeley and I studied, oh, you know, all the different art histories that were required. And it just really opened my mind. But I always kept my foot in the community. The pulse of the community has always been important to me. And I landed up meeting up with some women who were starting to create murals in the Mission District. And the name of the group was Mujeres Muralistas, which meant women muralists, is basically what it meant. And for me, that was the first time that I had ever been part of a collective as such of artists, in particular women. And me being like a country girl, they were like from the big cities, and you know, some of them were from Puerto Rico. Different people came in and out. One of the main people was from Venezuela. So it was like a real chance for me to like sort of open up my own idea of what it means to be Latino and what it means to be a woman. And it was very empowering, needless to say, sort of just being with women. Of course, it was pretty rowdy now and then because everybody was very strong and opinionated, but we all had something to contribute. My coming from the countryside, I would sort of give advice on how to draw some of the plants, because they were drawing plants that they looked like they were mutations from Mars. I mean, that's not a tomato, get over it. Whatever, they just didn't know. So anyway, it was a back and forth type of a thing. But this was in the 70s, and that is what you're seeing here. Oh, how do I do this? Down. Okay, and you can see on the, your right, that's me, 40 pounds earlier. And I'm depicting sort of a scene picking grapes, just sort of revisiting my own life as a child. And that piece landed up being like at City Hall, and there was this great big old event and all of that, so it was very, very wonderful. But that was a real turning point in my life. And when I went back to school, I kept sort of meeting up with different people and sort of learning my awareness of being Latina and the whole thing about people from the Americas and what have you was just sort of growing. And I got involved with the Pan-Indian movement at UC Berkeley, and it was students, they were from all over the Americas, the Caribbean, South America, Central, in Canada, as well as Mexico and the US. And they were writing an article about mercury poisoning of an Indian tribe in Canada. And some Japanese people came who had a similar incident in their community, and they came to Canada to help. So anyway, I was asked, because I wasn't good at writing, I wasn't good at organizing, I could dance, but that was not gonna help. They needed somebody to illustrate the article. So this is what I came up with. And it's like this size, it's tiny. Oh, this one has gotten me in a lot of trouble. I did this when I was a student at UC Berkeley, and I was feeling pretty sassy going back to school. It was kind of the height of the feminist movement, the Chicanas, we were all fired up too. And we were taking karate classes. I was no good, and you know, but it was fun. I liked the outfits. Okay, but it was right about that time that my grandmother had died. And if you're Catholic, you know, usually when somebody dies on the little memorial, little card that they give you, they usually have an image of the Virgen of Guadalupe, the patron saint of Mexico. Well, I thought about it, and I thought, you know what, that doesn't work with my grandmother, because she was very, very strong and powerful. Very, very independent woman. So I kind of revisited the image and liberated her, according to some people, from her 500 years of whatever, holiness. so, but that image offended and continues to offend a lot of fundamental Christians, Mexican in particular, Catholics, who think that this is against everything, against men, against virginity, against blah, 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 blah. Maybe so, but it's a real personal statement that I had no idea when I did it, the impact that it was going to make. And it's probably for the best, because I probably would have been scared to death. This is another piece that I did. I was learning how to etch at Berkeley. And it was the year of the American Bicentennial. So I love holidays. So I just wanted to have a little bit of fun with it. So I just decided, well, see, that's kind of me up there, because I was also taking classes in anthropology and learning about the Mayan Indians and about our presence in the Americas for 30,000 years and, you know, feeling kind of sassy behind that too. So it was just kind of my idea of just reminding everybody, including us, that we have been here a long time and that we come with the land and we're part of the land, basically. But this one also has been extremely controversial, especially now with all of the immigration drama and problems and everything that's happening behind that. Oh, okay. This piece, again, is one of those pieces that came out of my life in the valley. Back in, I think it was 79, I went to go and visit my mother in Dinuba. And I don't know, does anybody know where Dinuba is? Yay! Okay. Off the 99, past Selma, between Kingsburg, about 8 miles east. Anyway, if you drive, Kingsburg is the headquarters for the Sun-Made Raisin Cooperative. Okay? So whenever I would go back and forth and back and forth to see my family, or when I was living over there, I would always see the Sun-Made signs. They were part of my life. Anyway, I went to go see my mother in 79, and she was boiling water, and it was like 110, and I'm like, what is going on here? This doesn't make sense. It turned out that the water table in that town, as well as other towns in that area, the water table had been contaminated by chemicals, agribusiness, the overuse of chemicals. So as a result, they didn't know what to do. They still don't know what to do. They shut down the well, so people had to either buy water, boil water. My brother was a hydraulic engineer, so he set up my mom a little filter that she shared with everybody in the little barrio. But anyway, so that was really shocking, and it really frightened me just thinking about all of the people that I knew in that particular area and my family, my community, who had cancer, and there was like a lot of different things going on, and not really knowing if it totally stemmed from that, but who knows. So anyway, it took me 2 years. I really couldn't let it go. It's easy to walk away from things like that and not say anything, but it just stayed with me. It really bothered me. And then one day I was going back to see my mom, and I saw the Sun-Made logo, and I said, there it is, I'm going to unmask it. So then I started to work on trying to figure out how I was going to unmask it, and this is kind of what I came up with. When I first did it, I couldn't give it away, not even for 20 bucks. It was way early in the environmental movement, and up to that point I was told that people just thought about farm workers as being this out there people, but they never really made the connection with anything else. They were just isolated out in the fields. If it was Dr. Shifra Goldman was probably the first person that wrote about it, and she said that it was the first piece that connected farm workers, the consumers, and the environment. And basically it's talking about the overuse of pesticides and its effects on farm workers, consumers, and the environment. This piece has been shown all over the world. It's part of the Smithsonian collection. People still are publishing it and all of that. Unfortunately, it's still relevant. I did it again in a different way, because it was like super, people wanted me to do more with it or whatever. So I created this kind of a Day of the Dead. It's like, 8 feet by 5 feet wide. And in the lower part, I did like a little installation dedicated to my father, sort of like what a farm worker, it would be like a farm worker would be seated there with his implements and his hat, the little radio, and the things that a farm worker would have, like from maybe the mid-70s. So, but I did it a little different because I put some slats in the middle and I painted them. You know, like, I don't know if you've ever seen those Mexican little folk things that they're kind of small things and they have Jesus in the middle and Mary and Joseph on the side. I took one of those apart, which was, and then I sort of did it, but of course with different imagery. And by special request, I then made a costume. And then a few years ago, I decided to revisit it in another way because the farm worker, the face of the farm workers had changed. It was no longer necessarily Chicanos. They were all working, either they had all left or they were working for the prison system, sadly. But the new farm workers are now mostly indigenous people from Mexico and Central America, in particular people from Oaxaca, with very, very, very rich cultures. This is a screen print. I did a lot of screen prints as a result of meeting people like Malaquias Montoya, who was one of the pioneers of screen printing for the community, and I had a chance to work with him, where he taught me and worked with me and has always been available to advise me when I'm working on something and I'm not quite sure technically where to go with it. This had to do with the trip that I made to Guatemala many years ago at the beginnings of the war against the Mayan Indians. So it was just my imagining that if I was from that village, I would have woven a shawl, which they were famous for their weavings, to tell the story of what happened to my people. So that even if everything was burned down and there was maybe one little piece of fabric left, it would still tell the story of what happened. And then I redid it again. A friend of mine asked me to make it a lot bigger, which was absolutely insane because it's so detailed and it was just plain crazy, okay? But I landed up finding some people who print fabric and they liked what I was doing because they were from Berkeley, some radical hippies from Berkeley, love them. And then, so they helped me literally screen print this huge canvas like about 60 times, okay? So yeah, so that was the Day of the Dead. Okay, we're shifting another story here, another direction. I'm just kind of showing you a little bit of the different things that I do. How much time do I have?
All night.
All night?
I know one's better than that. As long as we've got a battery, you can talk.
I'm not that kind of gal. How much time, really?
We only have till 6:30.
Okay, I'm gonna go through. Okay, this is a full-length dress that was screen-printed with coins, and it's telling the story about my grandmother when the revolution in Mexico, everything were out of control. My grandfather got himself in trouble with somebody, and they had to leave Mexico in the middle of the night, and my grandmother hid all of these things in her clothing. Well, when my grandmother died, like 70 years later, before she died, she told everybody that she had hidden money, but she didn't tell them where. So when she died, they tore the hell out of everything trying to find the money, and they couldn't find one penny. And then one day, they were sitting around the table telling her stories, and then somebody remembered that she was always sewing all the time. So then they started looking in the curtains, and then this and that, and this and that, and they found like $60,000 worth of dollars, pennies, nickels, quarters, whatever, that she had been squirreling away like for 60 years. So I kind of did this, and just wondering what I would do if I had a sort of, I don't know if she was thinking that if something happened again, she was ready to leave, or she could just grab a few things, I don't know. I will never know, but it always sort of stayed with me in terms of like if some really horrible thing happened and we had to move, what would I take? This is a piece I did. This is kind of a woman that just was selling flowers right by where I live and near a gallery there.
and very entrepreneurial. She was from Mexico, really hardworking, really dedicated. The typical immigrant story, you know, came trying to make a new life, a better life for herself and her children. And I just wanted to honor her and also to acknowledge that we all, unless you're Native American, we all come from immigrants. And it's the same story for a lot of us. It's real easy to forget once we've been here a long time. But in general, or unless you're African American and you were brought here not by choice, but in general, all of us are children of immigrants. So it's kind of a reminder, but also a celebration of the strength, in particular, of the women to sort of reinvent themselves and to continue. Okay, this is kind of, I like to do a little bit of everything. Sometimes it's real serious, and sometimes I just want to have fun, okay? Get over it. This is a friend of mine, Astrid Haddad. She's one of Mexico's most famous performing artists. And her work is, she's a singer, she's of Lebanese Mexican ancestry, and her work is about making fun of the stereotypes of Mexican women, which is pretty fun. And she's amazing, anyway, absolutely amazing. And she has all of these unbelievable costumes that she wears and just changes through one performance maybe 25 times, and they're all totally outrageous. This one is another one that gets me in trouble because people don't quite get where I'm coming from. It basically, just quickly, it has to do with the fact that the immigrants are sort of being blamed for everything, in particular the Latino, the Mexicans and all of that, for everything, that it's just absolutely, absolutely ridiculous. So I just sort of carried it to the extreme by including the Virgen de Guadalupe. Okay, this, you have to sort of read the text, but we don't have time. You can go onto my website and you can sort of read the text, okay?